Hello everyone, this is Nitpicky Nerd, and today I want to talk a little bit about some of the problems in the movie First Contact, which I still think is the most entertaining Star Trek movie overall, but it does have a whole bunch of problems which are easy to nitpick, but I will also try to offer excuses, explanations and theories to try to explain it, and also suggestions on how it could have been done and should have been done. So first of all, the whole setup of the movie, the whole beginning of it, of the Borg using time travel, it begs the question, why couldn't they do that outside the Federation borders and then get to Earth in the past with no interference, without having to fight fleets of ships trying to stop them, as they did in the movie, and just barely managed to get to Earth and then send that one sphere through the time vortex. Possible ways to explain it is, first of all, it might have been a spontaneous decision. The Borg probably preferred to assimilate humanity in the future and not the one in the past, because they wanted to get all their technology and infrastructure, so it could have been a last moment decision. Other possible explanations, maybe they are aware of the existence of the time police in the future, and so if they did this kind of tactic, such as jumping to the past from a long distance from Earth and then spending time to get to Earth in the past, it might have given the time police in the future the necessary time to try to stop them. Maybe they had some experiences like that, but if they did that as a surprise decision in the last moment, immediately appearing at Earth in the past and immediately striking in the most vulnerable place that would ensure the Federation doesn't exist later, they were probably hoping to wipe out the time police before they had a chance to react to this decision. So it's all a little bit fishy, because, you know, time travel, they should have all the time in the universe to know about this in advance, then they probably have temporal shieldings, but still we can assume this is all part of some kind of temporal war between various powers, and maybe by doing that in the very last second would make it harder for anyone in the future to try to stop them, and so they immediately jump to the most vulnerable place in history in which they could prevent the entire Federation from forming, which was the day before First Contact, and they immediately targeted Cochrane's warp ship. And so because it all happened so fast, there was little time, little window of time in which someone could try to stop them. Another thing that always bugged me in that scene is, why are the torpedoes that the Borg fire are so weak? We can see them hitting, and they cause the damage of a small hand grenade maybe, and so couldn't they just shoot one antimatter torpedo into it and just cause a nuclear explosion and wipe out the whole area? So it makes no sense. This is in the past, so this is before Earth has any kinds of planetary shields or anything like that that can weaken the weapons being fired at it. And so why the hell are the weapons so weak? One excuse is to say that maybe the time vortex itself damaged or weakened some of the systems of the Borg sphere, and so that's why they are so weak, that's why they are so easily destroyed by the Enterprise, which also they said they have some system problems because of the passage through the vortex. They lost their shields, for example. That's also what allowed the Borg survivors to beam to their ship, to the Enterprise, and we don't know how many Borg drones beamed over, but I guess it had to be at least a dozen. And as for the Borg themselves, a lot of people complain about this movie kind of reimagining the Borg. Suddenly they have a queen, suddenly they're all basically brainless zombies working for the queen. I think this movie actually had a perfect setup to have a different kind of Borg collective, because they said that these Borg are disconnected from the main collective because they're in the past, and at this time the Borg are only in a distant quadrant of the galaxy and they have no way to contact them. That's why they had that whole scene of the Borg shrine to reconfigure the deflector dish to make contact with the other Borg in this century. And so it's established that this group of Borg are actually disconnected from the main collective, and so they are still a small collective of those few Borg drones, but it might be enough to explain a different kind of behavior. So maybe this Borg should act less like zombies and more closer to an individual, just like Hugh in the episode I, Borg, was very quickly becoming an individual again because he was disconnected from the collective. In the beginning he was still kind of talking like all the Borg talk, you will be assimilated, resistance is futile, all of those things which I guess are programmed into them, so it's not just a matter of being part of the collective, but also maybe some form of an AI, maybe as part of their implants. So I'm fine with the Borg still behaving like Borg even when they're disconnected, but I think it could have been interesting, it would have improved the movie to see that maybe some of these Borg drones in the movie are not behaving like the typical Borg we know, but maybe have some kind of personality traits resurfacing, you know, sort of like in the movie Universal Soldier. They had those zombie soldiers in the course of the movie. Some of them begin to display their old personalities. So the bad guy of the movie started regaining his personality that he had before, started becoming sadistic and all of that, not acting by his programming. And so I think this movie could have done something like that, and that could explain the whole thing with the Borg Queen. She could have been just a normal drone who, because of this disconnection with the collective, could have had some kind of personality of her own forming, and maybe that way she can become like the leader of this small group of Borg drones. Just like what happened with Lore in the episode Descent, those Borg who got disconnected from the collective were disorganized, and then they were seeking a leader, and then Lore came along and became their leader. So they could have a similar setup here. Of course, this is a movie, they don't really have enough time to explore it, but it could have at least been hinted at, and that could explain why the Borg suddenly are so different. It's no longer a big collective. Instead, some of the Borg apparently have personalities. So the Borg Queen, who was never actually called the Queen in this movie, and she never said she's the leader of the Borg. And that's why I never had a problem with her in this movie. And I think the actress was great and the design was great. And so I actually kind of like her in this movie. And they could have easily explained away all the problems by saying that this is something that the Borg improvised. Maybe it was only a way to try to seduce Data, to try to convince him to give them control of the computer, because that was the only thing stopping them, because he was the one who encrypted the computer and they couldn't hack his brain, so they have to have him cooperate. And so maybe they kind of improvised this whole thing to try to seduce him, and this is not something the big collective would normally do, but this small group of Borg drones might have a kind of more original thinking because they're closer to individuals. And also I think the Borg Queen should have been an assimilated member of the crew, instead of being like a queen who always existed, and they had flashback scenes of her being on that old Borg cube with Locutus, which didn't make any sense. I wish they wouldn't have done that. I think it would have been much better to have her be an assimilated crew member, like that one we saw in the very beginning when the Borg only started assimilating people on the ship. We saw a female officer climbing into those Jeffrey tubes and getting assimilated. I think that should have been the same actress as the Borg Queen. And then we would understand that the Borg Queen was not an individual, she was not a person who always existed who controlled the Borg. Instead, it's a tool used by the Borg, that she was created on the spot to achieve a certain mission. I think that would have worked much better. It would also make it much more creepy, because if we had seen her as a human in the beginning, and now suddenly she's this monster, then it would be much more creepy, and we would understand it's not really a person, it's only kind of a tool of the Borg and not an individual, which kind of ruins the whole idea of the Borg anyway. I think the fault lies mostly with Voyager, who kind of brought her back in multiple episodes and always showed as if she's the leader of all the Borg. The entire Borg collective is just her servants. That I think really ruined the Borg. In this movie I could accept this scenario because of the strange setup of this being a small group of Borg drones who are disconnected from the collective. And because this Borg Queen was trying to seduce Data, we can assume that was her whole purpose, and she was not really a leader of anything. And also they had that thing in the end when she died and all the Borg died. That's also a very lazy and cheap way to defeat an army of bad guys. Just kill the leader and they all die. I really hate that kind of easy solution, so they should not have done that. Other problems in the movie, there was that continuity mistake of Riker saying that the moon looks a lot different in his time, even though we saw the moon in a lot of episodes of TNG and Voyager and Deep Space Nine, and it always looked exactly like it looks like today. One way to explain it is saying that maybe Riker lied to try to inspire Cochrane to succeed in his mission, and so he exaggerated. On the other hand, maybe when they released the Blu-ray of TNG, maybe they should have added all those colonies to the moon so that Riker's line will make sense. It will fit what we saw in the shows, but then I guess they would also have to fix those episodes of Deep Space Nine and Voyager and add special effects to them. And ironically, Star Trek Discovery is the only one who kind of showed the moon like what Riker described it, with all kinds of cities on the moon being very visible. That's the only show that actually fits his line. Also, this movie had some continuity mistakes with the original series, which I think could have been easily avoided, and I will explain. For example, they said that the Third World War happened in 2053, even though Spock specifically said that it happened during the 90s of the 20th century. Now, we can't say they retconned it, but I think they could have simply avoided this continuity problem by saying that was the last nuclear war or something like that. Simply don't call it WW3. Simply don't name the war, and that way you avoid the continuity mistake. Even though I guess it still would be a mistake, because Spock said that that war was the last war, last major war on Earth, something like that. So it would still be a little bit fishy, but at least it wouldn't be such a direct violation of continuity. And also, it violates something that was said in the first episode of TNG about the post-atomic horror. When Q recreated that court of that time period, he specifically said that was a court of the year 2079. So this is over 10 years after this movie is set in. And so we have all these scenes in this movie of people telling Zefram that all of humanity will get united, it will get better so rapidly, so quickly, right after first contact, it will change all of humanity, poverty, war, disease, everything will be gone in a few decades. All of that is great. I love all those lines in that movie, but I just wish they would have set this movie just a little bit later in the 21st century so that it would fit what we saw in the first episode of TNG, in which we see the post-atomic horror, and it's said to be in 2079. Over a decade after first contact. And so how come things got worse and not better after first contact? Maybe it was kept a secret, maybe it was viewed as a conspiracy. Most of humanity didn't believe it at first, only later when the Vulcans came back again, years later, maybe then all of humanity started improving. But still, it kind of bugs me that it's a continuity mistake, which they could have easily avoided by simply setting this movie just a little bit later. Just set it in 2083 instead of 63. You can still have the date of the war itself being the same date, because I think Picard did say that that was in the mid-21st century, and so that does fit. But have the whole story of First Contact be set after the post-atomic horror that we saw in Encounter in Farpoint, and then it would all make sense. We can assume that the post-atomic horror was the low point of humanity, and right after that First Contact happened, and then it started improving. Then everything would fit together, and even the age of Zefram Cochrane was also inconsistent with TOS, because I think his age was mentioned there. And if you calculate all of that, it makes him a very young man in this movie. It makes him like 30 years old and he doesn't look it, so it makes no sense. And so it would have been better off to simply set this event much later in the timeline, toward the end of the 21st century, and then everything would make sense. Also, in some episodes of the animated show, it's been implied that warp drive is relatively new, maybe a few decades old, and so because of this movie we know that warp existed since the 21st century, but it's a continuity mistake because we saw an old lady in the animated show who said that she was the first doctor on a warp capable ship and she was still alive, so it couldn't have been more than 100 years before. And also in an episode of TNG called A Matter of Time, when Riker was asked what's the biggest achievement of humanity in the last 200 years, he said it's the warp drive. Without it, humans were stuck in one sector of the galaxy, and so it seems to sound as if Riker thinks that warp drive was invented in the 22nd century. So once again, it's a little bit of a continuity mess, and so maybe this movie should have been set in the early 22nd century instead of the mid-21st century. So that would fix all of these continuity mistakes altogether, and so this is something that bugs me about this movie, that I didn't pay attention to details like that, which they could have easily avoided. It wouldn't change anything about the movie. It can have the exact same plot and everything, simply do it without violating continuity, and that would be much better. And as for the moon scene, I would be totally fine with that if Riker said that when they were out in space already and maybe passing next to the moon, and then he would look at the moon and said it looks much different, then I could buy it, because even though we did see the moon in a lot of episodes, but we didn't really see it close by from every angle, so that would be the perfect opportunity to insert that line. Simply have him say that after they're out in space already and they're close to the moon, and then have Riker say, look at that, it looks a lot different than my time, then I would be totally fine with that. But he said that when they were still on the surface and he looked at it during daytime, and he was complaining that it doesn't look like it does in his time. That's totally ridiculous, it doesn't fit. So the only explanation is that he was lying in that scene to try to impress him, and I don't like that. And so that's some of my problems with this movie. We also have all the personality traits. I talked about that a lot of times, I don't want to repeat it. The fact that Picard is behaving like a lunatic in this movie, even though in TNG, even though he was traumatized by the Borg experience, but he overcame all of that during the series itself, especially in the episode I, Borg, in which he managed to overcome his anger and to not seek vengeance against the Borg. And yet in this movie, he goes totally nuts in some places. Maybe it's because he lost his family in the previous movie and that drove him a little bit crazy. So I covered some of the points which I didn't mention before in this video. So I hope it's been enjoyable. Let me know what you think in the comments below, and we can continue discussing and analyzing all of that in the comment section. I'll be glad to hear all of your points, especially if you disagree with me about something, you want to argue something with me, we can debate it. I love doing that, so be free to say whatever you think, and we can discuss it in the comment section below, and I will see you all next time. Bye bye.